I'll just use this one right here, okay? All right, praise the Lord. Good morning. I am so glad y'all are here. Y'all starting to get well. Thank you, Jesus. I tell you what, somebody gave me the plague right before I went over there to Missouri and stuff. I probably won't name their names, possibly, or something like that. She threatened me if I gave it. But anyway, we've got through it. We've got a lot of sick people. There's been a lot of people that have been sick from flus to pneumonias and everything else. So y'all keep them in your bulletin today. You're going to see a very large prayer list and praise reports. Don't forget, as we put names on that prayer list, as you see the results, give God all the praise and glory. I want to read this card to you today. It says, thank you so much. You see, when I asked God for help, I wasn't expecting such an awesome response. To our church family, thank you all for your kindness, visits, and prayers and food before, during, and after my mother's funeral. With warmest thanks from the family of Helen Huff, as Alan and Paula Huff, yours in Christ. And so I want you to remember them in your prayers. They're here with us today. And bless their heart. And I tell you what, it's a wonderful thing when you have a church family. I don't know how you make it without church family. So me and Tedger and Nathan just come back from up there in Missouri, and I was at an evangelism conference. They was right there with my daughter and stuff. But I did have a good trip. And one of the things I want you to know about is the importance of, if you're in a Southern Baptist church. So what does that matter about being Southern Baptist? We're evangelists, each one of us. And y'all have heard, most of you have heard this a million times. But let me ask you, have you ever noticed what's going on just around you? Somebody sitting next to you today? You know, and when you're sitting in church, you know, we come, we hear the word of God, and we praise and we worship him, and we're getting fed, hopefully, in the name of Jesus. And as we're getting fed, a lot of times we don't take the time to notice what somebody's going on in their lives right next to you. When I was up in Missouri, one of the things I noticed was I was in one of the fastest growing places in the United States. I was in an evangelism conference, the highest attendance in a church that this would sit in over 2.5, maybe 3 times, just in the sanctuary, this whole structure. They averaged in the 20s in attendance. I want you to think about this. They was even shocked when they seen me there. One of the hardest things about our lives today is that we forget our calling. Now, we had a lot of people, some of our adults sacrificed, and they brought our youth down to the Winter Jam yesterday. And y'all enjoyed that? That was good stuff? It was good stuff? It was Winter Jam. I know Brother Charlie, Brother Richard, and several other people. I see Miss Angie, Brother Daryl. Where's Brother? We have them here, and as they went with our youth to hear the message, and they were listening to youth praise and worship music, and y'all heard the word. They was preaching up there too, Charlie. They was preaching up in there, and you know, we have a wonderful church that sacrifices. But you know, even today, even though there's a lot of people that's been sick, and we have a pretty good attendance here. I'm so glad you're here. Have you ever thought about how many people are not in church today? Have you ever thought about how many people are not in church today? So, here's your message. We must be evangelists. Because even in the largest, most contemporary churches in the United States, if they don't have people that are reaching out and winning people for Christ, we're not doing our job. But praise God for each and every one of you. Praise God for every Sunday school teacher. Praise God for every worker who's got their hands to the wheel. So I want you to look on this. You'll see several announcements in here. There are several different things coming up. I'm going to take notice of that. Excuse me. And remember, somebody might need your help. So if you get a chance, contact somebody. Invite them to hear the gospel message. Anything else? We good? All right.
Next Sunday. Thank you.
Okay. We
Everybody ready to sing this morning? Feel good? Smile on your face?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Victory in Jesus. Let's stand together as we sing. If that song don't bless your heart this morning, something's wrong. A lot of you are not singing. I tell you, I can feel His presence here this morning with me. Amen? Let's sing that last verse like you really mean it. I heard standing for our opening prayer. Brother Wesley, would you lead us as we pray? Amen. Amen. Footsteps of Jesus. Face with Christ my Savior. This will be our offertory hymn. Let's stand together as we sing. Miss Sharon is going to come and do our special for us this morning.
You know, it's amazing how God works things out, because I didn't have any idea what Brother Raymond was going to have for choir special, but I've had this song on my mind all week after Miss Sandra called and asked if I would sing. The name of it is I Believe, and it talks about heaven. One of the dearest subjects to my heart, heaven. It also talks about Mama, and that's one of the dearest to my heart, too. So I hope you'll be blessed. I hope it'll just give you a little glimpse of heaven and what he has prepared for us to come. And, you know, we see glimpses of his glory all the time. We don't have to wait. I mean, it's all around us. All you have to do is just open your eyes and open your heart, and it's here.
When I see the sunrise in the morning, when I feel the wind blow across my face, when I hear the sound of children playing, I know it's all part of God's amazing I And I believe
All right, Brother Charlie. Hallelujah. I don't know if y'all ever noticed back there, but Brother Charlie and Brother Jerry work in our sound booth, and they put all this, the different music words, and they take the time out of their lives to minister. And a lot of times you take that for granted until you go to like an evangelism conference, and it squeals through the entire conference. If you'll open your Bibles, Ephesians chapter 2, and they were doing the best they could, by the way, but always appreciate those people. There's different areas of the church somebody's always working in. It's things we take for granted. There's always somebody doing something. They don't wave banners or nothing like that, but they're always working for the cause of Jesus Christ. Ephesians chapter 2, look at verse 1. You know, as I was at this conference, there's some things that was very important I think we should look at. We're kind of live in an island area because we live out here in the Homochitta Forest, and we live in an area that's very isolated. But all of surrounding you, is the world is out there. And our young people have the technology to actually be a part of it. And one of those things that's out there is they were given some statistics, some of the evangelists, on the percentages of people that ever attend church. You're actually a rarity. You know, it shows that in 1940s, in the early 50s, over 80-something percent of all people attended church regularly. By the 1960s, less than 30% were attending church regularly. 2017, less than 10% attend church, period. Ever. So you're a rarity. You're a novelty. So I praise the Lord for each and every one of you. But as I look at that statistic, you know, because of what we believe, that only through Jesus Christ can you be saved, where do you reckon these people are going? What do you think is happening in our world? Now, this isn't to bang on kettles. I want you to ponder, because these things make me ponder. Because I don't know about you. You know, a lot of times when a preacher gets up and starts preaching and stuff, a lot of people say, well, you're stepping on toes. It's not to step on toes. It's because of the situation that we're in. If you actually believe that there's a heaven and a hell. Now, you never heard nobody preached in the hell, did you? Have you ever heard somebody get up there and say, well, so-and-so, they went, they was the devil, and they went to hell. You never heard that. And preachers do a good job to make you feel good, and you know, because we want to have compassion and empathy for the people that are sitting there as lost loved ones that would give you the shirt off their back. But what is their relationship to Jesus Christ? And then what is our, if we claim to be a born-again believer, seriously, what compels us to do what we do? Are we driven to share the love of Christ with somebody? Because many of you know many good people that don't have a relationship. Let's face it. I ain't going to ask you to raise your hands, but I can raise mine. I know a lot of people that do not have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, and they're going to bust hell wide open, y'all. That's not threatening. That's not to make people weep. Here's what I want you to think about. This is serious. And when we come to worship Jesus Christ, every single week it's such a blessing. We get the ability to come and worship together. Don't ever take it for granted. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. If you can stand with me as we read God's holy word this morning. Well, what you reckon? We got the heat on. Y'all mind if I turn the heat off? Is everybody okay if I turn the heat off? Okay, thank you. If y'all okay with that, I'm going to turn the heat off. It's all right. And you know, and I'm not going to set it where y'all get cold or nothing like that, but I'm sweating buckshot. And I know y'all, that's rude as a preacher runs around here and he's he records all this. This heat's on here too. So, we're going to go like that. All right, praise the Lord. Let's read God's holy word this morning. It says, you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, of the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Let's use that as our opening scriptures today. Father, we thank you for your holy word. I thank you, Father, for the privilege to be able to present the message. Lord, within I myself, there's not much to me. But Father, I ask that the Holy Spirit would anoint me to speak your truth in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Several years ago when I was watching the news, they had a cave-in at one of these, a mining site. And it's one of those mines, I think it was down there in Mexico or something like it was in South America. And they were going real deep to mine some kind of mineral. And as they were in there, there was a collapse. And they were interpreting on the TV what these people were saying. And as these families, these moms, these dads, these children, these wives, all these individuals were at the front of this great big deep cave-in tunnel, and they were crying and they're saying, "They're lost! They're lost!" Now, what's so strange, when I was looking, I said, well, they know where they're at. And they knew where they're at. But even though you're saying we know where they're at, they're still lost because we can't get to them, or we're not able to reach them because we've been cut off from them. When we look at our lives a lot of times, we look at how people are lost in this world and they're separated from Jesus Christ, and it doesn't seem like we can reach them, even though we know where they're at. Many of them are right next door. Listen, you might be sitting in that pew today and you're not here by accident. And you might be sitting there and you might have been dipped in the water, but the question is, are you truly saved? And if us as born-again believers, if we're truly saved, how are we reaching out to our community? What does it mean to be lost? If the children of Christ can see what it means to be lost, that spiritually separated without God in their lives, it should be motivating. It should be pulling in our heart. Matter of fact, it should become your priority. So here it is. We look and we see this situation, and we look for the answers in the Word of God. What does it mean to be lost? And there's no better place I believe you can turn than right there to Ephesians chapter 2. And you look at it. One thing, to be lost is to be a spiritually dead individual. So when you're lost and you're away from Christ, you're dead in your life. That lost person is cut off from the spiritual life, from the power of living in Christ. See, as born-again believers, we receive that power of the Holy Spirit to go forth in the boldness and to do things that other people can't accomplish, not in our own strength, but by the power of God in us. And that condition of being lost is called dead. Yet spiritually, death is brought on by the sins in somebody's life. Those sins, and no one likes to talk about sin because we don't want to say someone's doing wrong or something like this. And it's not the preacher's job to convince you you're lost. The realization is you should realize that you are lost. That without Jesus Christ in your life, that your life is separated and you're feeling it in your heart right now. The specific sins, what happens is these sins in our lives, as we get to doing them, it becomes a habit. It's like somebody cussing. You ever know somebody who cusses all the time, and they don't even realize that they're cussing? Someone who drinks all the time, they don't even realize, they just drink. Someone who's out there living separated, and it doesn't even bother them anymore. See, a habitual sin is this disease. It's kind of like that fever. When I was coming down with this flu or whatever it is, and it started out, I was just getting a headache. And then I started getting these chills, and then I started getting fever, and it would go up. It was going right at 102 temperature, and then my stomach was rolling. I was hurting all in my joints. I had the symptoms. See, a lot of times, as this, you get so used to doing sin in your life, you become that spiritually insensitive to the things that are around you. That's why you can go see the movies that you see, or you can get on your phone and everything, and if you notice that the pornography doesn't bother you, because what happens is you're no longer sensitive to it. It doesn't make you turn away from it. It's like cussing and stuff. You know, as you're watching TV and you hear it, you become so attuned to it, so used to it, so in that habit of hearing and living those things that you become where it doesn't even bother your heart anymore. Dr. Lee, he was like the sponsor of where I graduated over there in Florida Baptist Theological College. And we had a chapel, and it was R.G. Lee Chapel. So we would always study his sermons and stuff, and he had this great sermon that I had talked about before, but it's a payday someday. And he would take 2 weeks, and I want you to listen to this, in a revival and preach the exact same sermon over and over. Now, can you imagine? And every single time they had the sermon, it was filled up. The place was overflowing. But when you start reading this particular sermon, Dr. Lee talked about when he was down there in New Orleans, he pastored a very large church. And outside, right there in New Orleans town there. And as he was there, he had this guy that used to call him. And this guy, he called himself the kangaroo court. What was it? The chief of the kangaroo court. And he used to call Dr. Lee, and he'd call him at his house, and he'd call him sometimes at the church, and he'd call him and sometimes in the mornings on Sunday, and sometimes in the afternoons, and sometimes at night, and he'd call him throughout the week sometimes, just different times. He'd just pick up the phone and call him. And as this man would call him, he says, "This is the chief of the kangaroo court." And what he used to do is he used to make fun of Dr. Lee, because Dr. Lee used to preach on that sin and how it had its wrong things and how it was destructive in your life. And this kangaroo court guy, he used to say, "Listen, you are wrong. Listen, Lee, let me tell you something." He said, "I'm going to tell you, all those things that you say are sin, that's just fun. All this stuff you're talking about, that one day that we're going to stand before some kind of holy and righteous court, that's just silly. You're lying to the people. What you're doing is being false so that you can make money and stuff. Do you really think, Lee, that we're going to have judgment one day? Do you really think that there's going to be God's accounting? I don't think so, Lee. I've been around here for a while, and I'm telling you, it's all a joke." One day, he got a call, Dr. Lee did, at his house one evening. It was in the evening time. He'd been home, and he's sitting at his chair, and the hospital, at the charity hospital, there was a very large one. Some of you probably know about it down here in New Orleans, and they called him, a nurse, and said, "Listen, Dr. Lee, there's some guy down here, and he's screaming for you." He said, "Well, who is it?" He says, "There's some guy, he keeps telling me to tell you he's the chief of the kangaroo court." And Dr. Lee says, "What?" And he went down there, and when he went down there, he was led to the room, and this man was hollering hysterically out of his mind. And as he walked into this room with the chief of the kangaroo court, his description, what he says, it was a man who had the appearance of someone who had been living in sin all their lives. And I've pondered that through the years. What does that mean? The appearance of. So the only thing I can say is someone who had been broken, torn, and weighed down with the sins of the world. And as he walked in there, this chief of the kangaroo court, he says, "Lee, I want to tell you something." He says, the devil is going to pay you off, all right. He says, he pays us off in counterfeit money. And when he said that, he perished on the spot. He died right then and there. The last words that man said was that he recognized that the God he had been scoffing at was he was going to stand before him very soon. Scripture teaches us that the wages of sin is death. But a lot of times we're listening to the old serpent, right? It says, "You will surely not die." I'm going to tell you something. One day each and every one of us will stand before a righteous and a holy God. To be lost is to be somebody who's helplessly enslaved to what the devil is trying to treat you with or give you. And that when you look at those particular scriptures right there, it talks about somebody who's enslaved to the spirit of the age. So what does that mean when we look at that? See, the characteristics of the spirit of the age are the ways of the world. The ways of the world is somebody who, the greed, the lust, the pride, the selfishness, that unrestrained kind of life. Anybody ever have road rage? Don't raise your hand. Unrestrained, they can't control their tempers, and you'll see them knock holes in the walls, and they can't resist things. Undisciplined people who just run away from all the laws. You know the government tries to place morality laws. In Louisiana, they made a law several years ago that said that you were required to talk to your teacher in elementary and high school stuff and call them Mr. or Miss. In other words, this basic thing of life that should have been taught by their parents. They had to make a law that said such things. And then if you look around, I don't know how many of you are exposed, but you see where we're trying to make laws to change things, but you see where the world is coming in, the porno, the phone sex. You see where the world is got casinos everywhere, and everybody says it's just fun. And we don't look at the end results of our society of what's taking place, because it's all about who? It's all about us. You see, when you're enslaved by that power of Satan, and you look at that verse 2 right there, the people of Paul's day, it talks about how the air was filled with evil spirits. So they believed that the evil spirits were always surrounding them in the air and stuff, and that this was all ruled by the devil. And what happens in our society is we regulate Satan to just a cartoon character. we regulate him to, you know, that devil's ham can. And we got a guy with a pitchfork and a long tail. And we say, that's the devil. And we make fun of him. And so what happens is our children, they don't grow up believing there is such a thing as demons or Satan or anything else. We regulate all this to a fictional character, and we make it out like a book, and then we walk away. That's why it doesn't bother us when our friends and family aren't truly saved. When our friends and family truly don't know Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, it should break our hearts. Look at the world. You look at this world, and you see where Satan is raging around, and he's doing so much destructive things, and he's directing activities. And you know how we always teach and tell, you know, the devil tells you 99.9% truth to get you a 0.01% lie so that he can lead you down the wrong path. Look at how many activities that we do that lead our children and our families and are away from hearing the message of Jesus Christ. One of the things they said at the evangelistic conference is most people do not know what they truly believe. Other people know so much word, but they never go out and witness. All they do is talk about the word. All they do is study, 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 and they never apply it by even going and telling someone and sharing it. The word is given to us so that we can go forth. Go ye therefore. And to witness and to testify. They had this old German preacher back there when it used to be an East and a West Germany. And they used to have these, from East Germany, there used to be all these migrants. They would go into West Germany, and they were taking them in from a communist nation. And they had a pastor, his name was Helmut Felick. And y'all probably read some of his books through the years or heard them quoted. But this guy, he used to go and to minister into the camp with all these different migrants, all these different immigrants right there. And they used to do what was called a puppet show. And they used to have one of these puppets, and it was called the Punch and Judy Show. Anybody remember that? They even had that on TV here one time, Punch and Judy. That's way before most people's times. But he used to get in there, and he had a red puppet, a puppet that looked like Satan. And he'd get in there, and he'd get in front of all these kids, and he'd tell the kids, you know, in that little puppet, and he'd say, listen, all you kids, what y'all need to do today is go around and stick your tongues out at all the people going around. And then every now and then, y'all go eat some bananas and be real tricky and throw it over there. He was making fun, right? He's going over there making fun. He says, and listen, when you get your feet dirty all day, don't wash your feet or nothing like that. Just jump up in your bed. That's what you need to do. Well, the kids started shouting down, of course, the devil puppet. And they would shout him down and tell him to get off the stage. And what was funny is the parents come in and said, you know what? Ever since you've been doing all this stuff up there on the different puppet show, these kids have been doing the opposite. They've been coming home and they're washing their feet and they're doing what we're telling them to do and they're actually behaving. Now see, the difference in the puppet temptation and the daily temptation that each one of us goes through is from the start, the puppet said that he was the devil. In our lives, the devil we face is sly. The devil we face comes in and says, listen, you know what? This is what everybody else does. Have you ever felt pressure because all the kids in your school or all your grandkids, they all have this. They all do this. It's the normal activity of everybody else, so we ought to do it too. I mean, I don't want my kid feeling uncomfortable, do I? And I don't want to have any kind of confrontation, not just ugly, but just to say, you know what, we don't believe in that. We don't do that. And so you go along with it just a little bit because it really doesn't seem to make a difference, does it? Or does it? When you go up and you see churches dying all around you, why do you think they started dying? You think it just started happening in 2017? No, they started dying over 30 years ago, y'all. They started dying because they lost something. They started compromising. And when we start compromising, what we do is we're starting to let the devil get a little bit of leeway in there. See, people, they get so enslaved by the spirit of rebellion. I don't know if you've heard this or not. What's one of the main problems? People are seeing all these people up north, and they don't even know what they're protesting, but they're protesting. Why? We're in rebellion. Against what? Well, I don't know, but I'm just telling you, I'm mad, and I ain't going to put up with it no more. And what you see today is we see that people are actually in rebellion against God. See, now when Paul, he's referring, when he talks about that disobedient, people are disobedient, is those whose lives are characterized by disobedience and that essence of sin in their lives. From Adam and Eve all the way to today, the whole heart of sin has been disobedience. You ever see anybody who hates authority figures? You ever see anybody who they just don't want to put up with it? I'm just not going, I don't care what anybody says. You see, when we look at these scriptures right here, people are enslaved by their own desires, their mind, and their central. Everything is central to my life. It's all about me, me, me. So you see, where it's not just sex with the flesh and the fleshly sins that happen right here. You see things that are taking over their lives as activities. Now, Paul lists some of the sins in Galatians chapter 5. Look at verses 19 through 21 right here. Look, see, now the deeds of the flesh are evident, which are immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery. Now, I stop on that for a reason. You see all these books they sell nowadays? They're harmless, aren't they? The little witchcraft books, right? You know, the what's them things called? What's that, Harry Potter? What's wrong with Harry Potter? Anything wrong? It's just fiction, right? Even though you can go on the internet and you see where they actually put spells for kids to practice. What's wrong with it, right? Look, enmity, strife, I know I'm going to make somebody mad. It's okay. I love you. It's okay. Jealousy. Look at this. Outburst of anger. You ever see that? You ever see somebody get stupid? Disputes, dissensions, factions. Watch this. Envying, drunkenness, and everybody says, oh, you're drunk, drugs. Carousing, and things like these, of which I forewarn you, just as I have forewarned you, that those who practice such things, listen to this, will not inherit the kingdom of God. You see, now, you can study the Greek of this. Now listen to me. And you know what will not means in Greek? Will not. You know what it means in Hebrew? Will not. But what happens is we give ourselves excuses and say there's nothing to it. And we don't realize how, even though you might be as a born-again believer who's strong and who can stand against things, and you may not know how it's affecting. I'm going to tell you how it affects people because I've seen it. It changes their thought process. You see, the mind Satan wants to attack right here. When you look at this, that flesh is that lower nature part of us. It's that point that sin comes in to attack. Kind of like, you know, your teeth, when you get a cavity, it's because you've lost that hard enamel that surrounds your teeth. And that's the reason you'll start getting a cavity. Sweets are great. We love them. But if you do not scrub off your teeth, you'll get points where the cavity comes in. And what happens when you get a cavity? Anybody ever get a swollen up head? Just become a little bitty pinhole. Makes your whole head swell up. And you hurt. And it looks like you got a big old pumpkin head or something like that. And it's all the result of one pinhole where the infection started slipping in at. That's what happens with people's lives when they live outside of Christ. It's not the obvious stuff that gets people. It's because they make excuses for things into their lives and they wonder, why am I not being blessed of God? To be lost is to be an object, it says in Scripture, of wrath. In Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3, look at what this says. It says, among them, we too all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh. Now watch. Among them, we too all formerly. All right? So I'm giving you Greek. Used to do it. Among them, we too all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh, indulging the desires of our flesh and of our mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. Now this is where people get fired up at. You see, we were the children of wrath. Those lost and without Christ, listen to me, await the wrath of God. Now, we don't want to hear that. People get so mad at me when I say these things. This is what Scripture says. I'm just a mouthpiece. There's not much to me. I'm the pot. God's the coffee. Whether you drink it or not is up to you. See, those people that are living outside of Christ, they're going to receive the wrath of God. They're objects. They're objects of the wrath of God. And I'm going to tell you, we shouldn't take God's wrath lightly. It shouldn't be something that we're joking about. This is not a game right here. This is eternity that we're dealing with. And God's wrath is revealed in that lost person's life because they become so callous. You know, people that would normally be loving, they're not loving. They get so hard. They get so insensitive. They're lost. They're lost. They're lost. See, when you look at this future aspect of the wrath of God, you know, the New Testament says that sin is being stored up for the day of wrath. It's building up. God is going to judge sin. And God's going to hold people accountable. Now listen, here's what we say, and we say it all the time, and watch, you know, watch. Because I know I'm going to get somebody and y'all come talk to me. Sin is an inanimate object. Okay, so if I say, well, you know, adultery is sin, right? But what is adultery? I can put the word adultery up here. It's a word. So who's going to get the wrath? Adultery, it's a word. Who gets the wrath? The adulterer. Do you understand that? It's someone who does that. We say, God hates the sin, but not the sinner. Now, here's what you need to know. Sin is not, it's just an inanimate object. It's a word. The individual does the sin. Who gets the punishment? The word or the individual? I know. I'm shaking you up. I know it. But it's serious to me. And not everybody is able to hear what I'm saying. Not everybody understands me. Because when I had this professor, he's talking to me. And I say that, you know, God hates the sin and not the sinner. See, God died for that individual. And he took what? The sins of the world on who? On himself. He took our sins. But here's the thing. If you don't repent and turn away from them, what are you doing? You're carrying them. You're carrying yourself. He says, I'll take your load. I'll make your load light. And we say, no, Lord, you can't carry this. It's too much for you. So you see what it means to be lost. But the thing is people don't have to remain that way. Good people go to hell because they will not say, I'm lost. It says in Scripture that everyone could be saved. Matter of fact, if you look in Scriptures, it describes the condition of the lost person. Among us, among them, we too all formerly lived in the lust of our flesh, indulging in desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature children of wrath, even as the rest. Charles Spurgeon, he never got tired of giving his testimony of how he was lost. And he had tried to earn his way to salvation. He had tried to work and do all these good deeds. And on this rainy Sunday, he went into a little chapel. And they had a little preacher up there. And his description was, he says, that little preacher was up there. And he said he was preaching the truth. And he preached out of Isaiah chapter 45, verse 22. It says, look unto me and be ye saved, all the ends of the earth. And when you think about that scripture, he says, and that preacher, he says, he comes all the way to the end of the sermon, and he said that preacher pointed his finger. You know, when you go to preaching school, one thing they always tell you not to do, they say, don't point. You know, put your hands and all. I mean, you actually go to school for this kind of stuff. I'm not good at it, obviously. But here's the thing. You've got to realize he was sitting in there, and as the Holy Spirit was talking to him, he said that preacher pointed that bony finger at him. He says, look. Look unto Jesus, and you'll be saved. And see, that morning, Spurgeon looked, this great evangelistic preacher back there years ago, and he repented of his sins. He accepted Christ as his Lord and Savior. It changed him. Because from then on, he learned what mercy truly was. Today, as you sit in here, I don't know you. You may not know me from Adam. I'm just a little nothing. I'm just a preacher. I'm not great at nothing. But I'm here to tell you Look unto Jesus. Look unto Jesus, and He'll save you. He'll change you. Church, we have to look at this world through the eyes of Christ and say, they need a Savior. It's not about me. It's not about my desires. It's not about what I want. It's about what Christ wants in me, because He has a plan for me. If I'll just take His plan, God can save anybody in your family. You say, oh no, Brother Blaine, I know so-and-so and he struggles with this and struggles with this. Let me tell you, I understand that. I have families that have struggled too. God can save them. When do we give up? Not as long as there's breath will I ever surrender. I'll keep preaching. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. Jesus saves. If you'll bow your head for just a moment. Today, as they're coming forward, as you're sitting there at this moment, I'm going to ask you one thing. If you were to die right now, do you know where you would go to? If you left this world at this exact moment, where would you be? The most important thing you need to be able to do is explain where your destiny is. God has guaranteed us something if you'll just take it, if you'll just accept it. I'm going to tell you something else. Don't give up on your friends and family. Don't give up on your community. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can make a difference in this world. As they're playing, won't you come this morning? Won't you come?
Pass me not, O gentle Savior.
Won't you come this morning?
Thou art calling. Do not pass me by. Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling. Lord, we thank You for another opportunity to come to Your house to worship You this morning. Lord, I thank You for each one that's here this morning. I pray, Lord, that we have, each one of us, received a great blessing from having come this way. Lord, we thank You for sending Your Son to die on the cross that we could have eternal life. Lord, we just thank You so much for blessing us from day to day. I ask You to lead us all to our separate homes now. Forgive us where we've failed You for these things. We ask in Your name. Amen.